Hey everyone, I'm Ian Norman from Lonely Spec, and today I want to talk about photographing the constellation Orion. Orion is one of the more interesting parts of the night sky. It contains a lot of the night's brightest stars, and has a ton of relatively bright nebula, including some of the most famous deep sky objects like the Orion Nebula and the Horsehead Nebula. We're going to be photographing all of the nebula in the entire constellation, collectively known as the Orion Molecular Cloud Complex. I'll show a way of stacking multiple exposures to reduce noise, and how to enhance their colors using a technique called LRGB processing. For this tutorial, I visited Red Rock Canyon State Park in California. It's about 2 hours north of Los Angeles, and its relatively dark skies and red rocky cliffs make it a really nice location for night photography. I spent most of my time there making photographs of the Geminid meteor shower, but I also took some time to make 32 separate exposures of the constellation Orion for this tutorial. To capture Orion, I recommend using a standard prime lens. That's about 35mm if you're on an APS-C sensor, or about 50mm if you're on a full-frame camera. We want our lens to have a relatively low f-number of about f2 or lower. I shot all of these exposures using a Sony Zeiss 55mm f1.8 lens, mounted to the Sony A7S, and a small travel tripod. Exposure settings for this exercise will depend a lot on the limits of your equipment, but if you're using a standard prime lens, I recommend starting with an exposure of about 10 seconds, the lowest f-number that your lens will support, and an ISO of 3200 or higher. We should try to capture a minimum of 32 separate exposures for this exercise to get the best results. Okay, let's get started with processing in Adobe Lightroom. I'll select the first of my 32 exposures, and I'll enter the Develop module. Now the very first thing I want to do is bring all of the noise reduction down to zero. The color details in the night sky can be very faint, and sometimes noise reduction can actually smear some of the details in our image. Once we've disabled noise reduction, I like to make some basic corrections to fix white balance. You can see that this image has an orange tone all across the image from an imperfect white balance. To get a roughly neutral white balance, I'll start by increasing the vibrance and saturation all the way to 100. This will allow us to better see the small changes in white balance and tint. If the image is slightly too warm, it'll look all orange, and if it's slightly too cool, it'll look all blue. The point at which we have an even mix of blue and orange in the image is our neutral white balance point. Now this image has a gradual change in color all across the frame, so I'm going to start by getting the bottom right corner of the image so that it looks like it has a good mix of blue and orange hues. Then I'll use the gradual filter tool to even out the image. I'll start by changing the filter so that it's just increasing white balance temperature, and then I'll drag it roughly across the frame and tweak the temperature so that the top left corner looks similar to the bottom right. Then I can adjust the position and size of the filter to try and even out the gradient. Okay, I think that's roughly good for this demonstration. We could spend a little bit more time trying to even out the blue top corners of the image, but I think this is pretty good for now. So once we have an even balance of colors in the image, we can return our vibrance and saturation sliders back to zero by double-clicking on their labels. Now the next thing to correct is vignetting. Just like correcting white balance, I like to first exaggerate the vignetting in the image, so this time we'll increase contrast all the way to 100 and also add a strong contrast curve to the image. Now we can scroll down to the lens correction tools, choose manual corrections, and then adjust the vignetting sliders until we have as flat looking an image as possible. Sometimes it's easier to see how even this adjustment is while looking at the navigator preview on the left-hand toolbar. So when it's about as good as we can get it, we can reset the contrast by double-clicking on its label, and then we can reset the curves by right-clicking on them and choosing Flatten Curve. Okay, so now we have a relatively flat, neutral image, so we're ready to apply all of our edits to the 32 images in our sequence. I'll select all of the photos, and then click the Sync Settings button, and making sure everything is checked, I'll click Synchronize. Okay, now we should be ready to stack all of these exposures together in Photoshop to reduce noise and enhance the colors of the image. So with all of the photos selected, I'll right-click and choose Edit In, Merge to Panorama in Photoshop. Now in Photoshop, we'll get this Photo Merge dialog box. We should uncheck the Blend Images Together button and then click OK. Then Photoshop will work away loading our images and automatically aligning them. When it's complete, we can stack the images together by selecting all of the layers, right-clicking one of them, and then choosing Convert to Smart Object. Once it's complete compressing everything together into a smart object, we can tell Photoshop to combine all of those images together using a median filter by selecting Layer, Smart Objects, Stack Mode, and then Median. And once it finishes, we can zoom in and see how it reduced the noise in the image. I'll go ahead and undo that so you can see the difference it made. Okay, so now that we've reduced the noise in the image, we can go ahead and flatten the image by clicking the Options dropdown in the top right corner of the Layers palette, and then choosing Flatten Image. And I'll go ahead and save our progress for now. Okay, so now that we have a noise-reduced image, we can start the LRGB process. LRGB stands for Luminance, Red, Green, and Blue. Essentially, we'll be working to create a high-contrast black and white luminance layer, and then we'll apply it to another layer with all of our photo's colors to create the final image. I'll start with some basic contrast edits by adding a curves adjustment layer, pulling down the shadows, and then increasing the highlights. I'll also add some roll-off to the highlights to try and retain more detail in this bright part of the Orion Nebula. Now, one of the things I want to point out is that the image still has a noticeable gradient from top to bottom. I want to even this out a little bit, so I'll use a levels adjustment layer to first reduce the brightness of the image. And then I'll view the level layer's mask by alt-clicking it, and then using the gradient tool with black as our foreground color and white as our background color, we can drag a gradient from the top to the bottom of the image. So now when we click on our layer again, we can see how our adjustment reduced the gradient. Once we have a relatively high contrast and evenly toned image, we can combine all of our layers into a smart object. Now I'm going to copy this smart object 3 times. We'll adjust each of these layers in a different way to bring out as much detail as possible. The top layer will be used to enhance detail and nebulosity. The second layer will be used for the fine detail in the image, and the bottom layer will contain all of our color data. We'll start by editing the bottom up, so I'll hide everything but the bottom color layer. This layer will be used to contain just the color detail in the image, so the first thing we want to do is eliminate all of the stars in the image by going to Filter, Noise, and then Dust and Scratches. And then I'll adjust the radius until the filter eliminates all but the very brightest stars. And then I can increase the threshold until it brings back most of the fine detail of the image. And once it looks about good, I'll click OK. Alright, so now we have an image that no longer has most of the faint stars in it. Since we'll have a separate layer for all of the detail in the image, we can also smooth out this color layer by adding a mild Gaussian blur of about 2 pixels to the image, just to smooth out some of the grain. Okay, so that just about does it for the color layer, so we can go ahead and move up to detail. This layer should contain all of our detail in black and white, so I'll convert it to black and white by adding a black and white adjustment layer. And then we can tweak the sliders to try and bring out a little bit of contrast. I'm adjusting each color such that it seems to bring out the most contrast possible while still keeping the tones natural. I like to increase the blues in the image, but we need to make sure when increasing it, we don't blow out the highlights, so we'll take a close look at the Orion Nebula. A lot of the nebulosity is magenta in color, so I'll increase that slider almost to 100 to try to make sure that the nebulosity is more visible. So once the detail is converted to black and white, we can increase the contrast of the image by adding another curves adjustment layer, dragging down the shadows, and then increasing the highlights. I'll also have the highlights roll off again to try and preserve our detail in the bright highlights. So once we're done with the detail layer, we can combine it and its adjustment layers into another smart object. And I'll go ahead and rename this to detail again. Okay, so now the final layer is the nebulosity layer. We want this layer to be a black and white layer of just the nebulosity. So similar to the color layer, we'll start off by eliminating all but the brightest stars by using the dust and scratches filter. And just like the color layer again, I'll smooth out the layer with a mild Gaussian blur. And then we can convert this layer to black and white using the black and white adjustment layer. This time we can be a little bit more extreme with our adjustments. So after converting to black and white, we can add a curves adjustment layer to increase the contrast of the layer. And once we have a nice contrasty image, we can combine the nebulosity layer with all of its adjustment layers by creating another smart object. And I'll name this again to nebulosity. Okay, so now we're ready to combine our detail layer and our nebulosity layer to create our luminance layer. We'll be using a technique called an inverted layer mask. We'll start by disabling the nebulosity layer and then selecting the detail layer and using Select All or Command A to select the entire canvas and then using Edit, Copy or Command C to copy the contents of the detail layer. Then we can re-enable the nebulosity layer and add a layer mask by clicking the Add Layer Mask button on the bottom of the layers palette. Then we can Alt-click the mask to view it and paste the contents of the detail layer into the mask by using Command V or Edit Paste. Now the final step is to invert the mask with Image Adjustments Invert or by clicking Command I on the keyboard. Now if we select our layer, we can see how the nebulosity layer increased the detail in the image. If we want to fine-tune the nebulosity layer, we can select the mask and use the levels adjustments with Command L to adjust the midpoint slider until we think it looks good. Okay, now we can combine our detail layer and our nebulosity layer into a group, and we'll call this group the luminance group. And then we'll set the luminance group's blending mode to luminosity. So now we have a top layer with all of our luminance data and an under layer with all of our color information. So the final steps of processing will just be to tune the colors of the image. I'll start by selecting the color layer and then adding a vibrance and saturation adjustment layer and then increasing the amount of color in the image. Then I'll tweak the colors a little bit with a color balance layer. All right, that looks pretty good. So now we'll make some final tweaks to add some extra punch to the image. I'll start by enhancing the glow of the bright stars in the image. The easiest way to do this is to copy our color layer by dragging it to the Create New Layer button on the bottom of the layers palette, and then dragging it to the top of the layers. I'll rename this layer to Star Glow. Then we want to adjust the levels of this layer so that we can only see the brightest stars. Then we can select the Star Glow layer again and add a Gaussian blur filter to it. And I'll just tweak the levels a little bit more to brighten up the stars. Okay, so now I'll select both the Star Glow layer and its adjustment layer and merge them together by right-clicking and choosing Merge Layers. And I'll rename this to Star Glow again. And then we'll set the layer's blending mode to screen, and now you can see that the layer adds a bright glow around the stars. This ended up blowing out the detail in the Orion Nebula, so I'll fix this by adding a layer mask, and then painting over the bright spot with a large, soft black brush. Alright, that looks pretty good. The last and final tweak is to make a final curves adjustment to give the photo that last little bit of punch. I think that looks pretty good, so we're ready to flatten the image and save it. So now we can return to Lightroom, where I'll crop out the electronic glow on the bottom of the image. And if we compare this image to one of our original images, you can see how much detail the process was able to recover from our files. Faint details like the Witch's Head Nebula were almost invisible in the original image. We can also see the Flame Nebula and the Horsehead Nebula and Barnard's Loop, all of which were very hard to make out in a single exposure. Alright, that just about sums up our editing process of Orion. Orion is a really great constellation to photograph around the turn of the year. It's visible in most parts of the world from October through May, and you can photograph it with a regular camera and a standard prime lens. Once again, I'm Ian Norman. I hope this tutorial was helpful. If you want to see more astrophotography videos, please subscribe, and check out all of our detailed tutorials, gear reviews, and inspiration at lonelyspec.com. See ya!